Leia here from leiaforsci.com/MCAT, and in this video, we're going to look at how to balance chemical equations. Stoichiometry, not only is it a difficult word to pronounce, it can also be a tricky topic. Stoichiometry comes from the words stoic, meaning elements, and metri or meter, which is balance. Simply put, stoichiometry is the balancing of equations. The law of conservation of matter tells us that matter cannot be created or destroyed, only transferred. This also applies to charge, as we'll see in balancing redox, where charge can't be created or destroyed, only transferred. This means that when we have a chemical reaction, all of the atoms that show up in the reactants have to show up in the same amounts in the products. Now they can change, they can have a different form, but the number of atoms have to be the same. Take a look at this synthesis reaction, where we combine hydrogen and oxygen to form water. For the sake of simplicity, we're going to omit phases, but what we see is that two hydrogen atoms react with two oxygen atoms to give us one water molecule, but if we count it up, water has two hydrogens and just one oxygen. Where did that second oxygen go? We can't simply add a subscript 2 into the molecule because that changes the entire chemistry, the entire nature of the product. We had water, which is safe to drink, and changed it to peroxide, which you definitely don't want to drink. Instead, we have to look at the stoichiometric coefficients, the numbers that go in front of the reactants and products, to figure out how many we have so that the total number of atoms are the same. There's two ways you can approach this. For something as simple as this, you can eyeball and do a guess and check method. We'll start with hydrogen. We have two hydrogens in the reactants, two hydrogens in the product, looks good. We have two oxygens in the reactant, but only one oxygen in the product. To get a second oxygen in the product, we want to double it, but not by adding a 2 here, by doubling the coefficient number, the number in front of the molecule. This doubles everything that follows, telling me that I now have 2 times 2 hydrogen for a total of 4 hydrogen, but I also have 2 times 1 oxygen for a total of 2. The oxygens are balanced, but in changing the coefficient in front of water, hydrogen changed to 4, which means we have to go back to the reactant and change it. To get a total of 4, we divide by what we have. 4 divided by 2 per molecule means that we need 2 because 2 times 2 is 4, and now everything is balanced. But wait a minute, oxygen doesn't have a coefficient. Remember that if there's no number in front of the molecule, it's an invisible one or an understood one, but some professors will ask you to add that one in. On the MCAT, it's less about giving the final numbers and more about understanding what's going on, so remember, if there's no number, it's an invisible one. This method of going back and forth worked for a simple reaction like this. But what if it's a little bit more complicated? Say you're asked to react iron oxide with carbon to give you iron plus carbon dioxide. Once again, we can do the back and forth method where we guess, but in this case, I'm going to urge you to take a few extra seconds and write out a checklist. This will keep you organized. This will keep your thought process clear, and you're much less likely to make a mistake. There's a few different ways to do this. Some people like to write out a checklist under each. Some people like to write out one checklist on reactants and products. I prefer to have my checklist right down the middle. So we have iron, oxygen, and carbon. I like it down the middle because it's faster. It's very clear about what's going on, and it serves as a nice divider between the reactants and products. Remember, it's all about being strategic but efficient with your time. The next thing you want to do is figure out how many atoms for each on the reactants and products. On the reactants, we have 1 iron, 1 oxygen, 1 carbon. In the products, we have 1 iron, 1 carbon, and 2 oxygen. When everything is balanced except 1, you go and balance that thing first. In this case, iron is balanced, carbon is balanced, oxygen is not. I have 2 in the products and 1 in the reactants. This is simple. If I have 1 and 2, I just double the side that has 1. Instead of placing a 2 in front of the iron, I like to put a small number at the top. The reason I do that is the number I put here may not be my final number, And if I have to change it, I'm either stuck erasing or crossing out, making this entire thing too messy to follow. Putting it on top allows me to change the numbers until I'm confident, then bring the final number down to the coefficient. Once you update a coefficient, make sure to rebalance everything that changed with that new number. In this case, oxygen changed from 1 to 2, but iron also changed from 1 to 2. I recommend crossing out and writing a new number rather than erasing. Because let's face it, you may not have an eraser. It can get really messy when you do erase. It's faster to cross out. But most importantly, if you need to go back and check your work, it's very easy to see what you've done when you have a trail of crossouts and numbers. Once you update the atoms, make sure to check again if everything is balanced, because changing a number, like iron, will throw off the balance we initially had. The only thing that's off now is iron. I have a 1. That means if I double it and place a 2 here, that gives me 2. Nothing else changed because it's a standalone element. Once it looks like you're done, check your checklist. Make sure that all of the atoms are balanced. In this case, I have 2 iron, 2 oxygen, 1 carbon. If your checklist is balanced, you know that your atoms are balanced, you know that your equation is good to go. Now is a good time to bring down your coefficients. I like to cross it out just to make sure there's no confusion. That gives me 2 FeO2, 1 carbon for the invisible one that's already there, 2 iron, and 1 CO2. Let's try another example. Say you're told to react aluminum with oxygen to give you aluminum oxide. First thing you want to do is write down your checklist. We have just aluminum reacting with oxygen. On the reactant side, we have 1 aluminum, 2 oxygen. On the product side, we have 2 aluminum and 3 oxygen. Both are imbalanced. Which one do we start with? I'd say it doesn't matter, because no matter which one you start with, you'll eventually wind up with the right answer. But when you have something that is 1 to 2, that's easy. I like to leave it for later, because you just double it. But when you have something that's odd and even, and you're not dealing with a 1, for example 2 and 3, I like to start there and do a crisscross to find the least common multiple. In this case, 2 times 3 gives me 6, so let's try to get 6 oxygens on either side. To get 6 oxygens on the reactant side, I need to have 3 O2, 3 times 2 is 6. To get 6 on the product side, I need to have 2 times Al2O3. 2 times 3 gives me 6. Don't forget to update anything else that changed. By putting a 2 in front of Al2O3, I now have 2 times 2 aluminum giving me 4, which is not balanced with 1 aluminum in the reactants. But since aluminum is standalone, it's very easy. Just turn that 1 into a 4. 4 times 1 is 4. Check your checklist. Make sure that everything is correct. 4 equals 4. 6 equals 6. Everything adds up, and that means our final reaction is 4 aluminum reacting with 3 O2 to give us 2 Al2O3. Let's try another example where we're asked to balance the reaction of CH4 plus Cl2 reacts to give you CCl4 plus HCl. Let's start with the checklist down the middle. We have carbon, hydrogen, and chlorine. In the reactant side, we have 1 carbon, 4 hydrogen, and 2 chlorine. On the product side, we have 1 carbon. We don't have just 4 chlorine, because chlorine shows up in 2 of the products. Make sure you account for both. We have 4 in CCl4 plus 1 in the HCl for a total of 5, and then 1 hydrogen. If you're looking at this and thinking, oh my goodness, what do I do next? Try to give yourself a system and figure out where it makes sense to start. In this case, something like carbon looks pretty simple. Hydrogen and chlorine are off balance, but chlorine shows up in more than one molecule on either side, in this case the products, so it might make sense to start there. I have 2 chlorines in the reactant and 5 chlorines in the product. Trying to balance odd and even is tricky, so you want to look for some multiple where you can multiply the two sides. One simple way would be to multiply 2 times 5 and put 10 on each side. If you had one molecule that had 2 and one 5, For example, you had some molecule Cl2 reacts to give you some molecule of Cl5, then you would multiply. But in this case, we're not necessarily looking for 10, we're just looking for the nearest even number that we can get to. There's two ways to approach this. You can play detective work or just do a guess and check method. Let's start with a guess and check. If I want to make chlorine and the products even, I have 4 in CCl4. I can just do 2HCl, and that easily brings it up. 2HCl means that we now update the hydrogen on the product side to 2, and the chlorines to 4 plus 2, which is 6. We can then put a 3 in front of the Cl2 to give a 6 on the reactants as well. The problem here is that chlorine is balanced, carbon is balanced, but hydrogen is not. If we have 4 on one side and 2 on the other, one side is double the other, we simply double the smaller number. So if we double the 2 to 4, then we change the 2HCl to a 4HCl. What changes as a result? 2 hydrogen goes to 4, 6 chlorine now goes to 4 from the HCl, 4 from the Cl4 to give us a total of 8. And once again, we're off balance. Carbon is still good, carbon hasn't changed, hydrogen is good, but now we have 8 chlorines in the products, only 6 in the reactants. Instead of thinking, how much more do I add, just give yourself a do-over and say, if I have Cl2 and I need 8, how many Cl2s do I need? 4. So we cross out the 6 and we recalculate that we have 4 times Cl2, which is 8, for balanced chlorine. Not only that, but carbon is balanced, hydrogen is balanced, and chlorine is balanced. The checklist adds up, so we know we're good. Our final numbers are 1CH4, 4Cl2 yields 1CCl4, plus 4HCl. If you want to play a little detective work, you could have caught the fact that the Cl here, which we changed initially to 2, is connected to a hydrogen that is only in multiples of 4 because of the CH4 and immediately jumped to the 8. If you didn't see that, that's okay, because this method still worked and still gave us the answer without too much confusion. What if you're asked to balance something more complex, like the combustion of ethane, C2H6 reacting with O2 to give us CO2 plus H2O, or something even more crazy, like this acid-base reaction between phosphoric acid and calcium hydroxide to give us calcium phosphate and water? You can go through and balance it the exact same way that I've shown you before, or you can use the shortcuts that I teach in the upcoming videos. And you can find this along with the reactions and stoichiometry practice quiz and cheat sheet. First, give this video a thumbs up. Make sure to subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss out on any new MCAT videos. Then visit my website, leahfrisai.com/reactions, for the MCAT stoichiometry and reactions practice quiz and cheat sheet. The link again, leahfrisai.com/reactions.